I know you've read about Linda Hirshman. She started out as a lawyer. She went from that to being a law professor. She's an author, writes some very interesting things, and it's really great to have you, so welcome.
Thank you. So I was thinking maybe I would just tell you a little bit about the book. This is a story about the public and private lives of the two most powerful women in America so far. And it tells about their relationship, but more importantly, it tells about how they, together and separately, achieved formal legal equality for women. When I got out of law school in 1969, the 14th Amendment of the Constitution did not apply to sex discrimination. It was only 2 years later, in the hands of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, that the Supreme Court ruled in Reed v. Reed that the 14th Amendment applies to sex discrimination. So the book opens on June 26, 1996. And for those of you who are not lawyers, the Supreme Court leaves its hardest decisions where they're telling the society to change in a major way, almost inevitably to the end of the term. So it gets tenser and tenser as the days go by in late June, and everybody knows these important decisions have to come out, and they're waiting. So on the morning of June 26, 1996, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, the second woman appointed to the Supreme Court of the United States, stepped through the red velvet curtain to deliver the opinion of the court in United States versus Virginia. United States versus Virginia is not a reenactment of the Civil War, despite the title. It is the case about whether the Virginia Military Institute, which had been training men since before the Civil War, had to admit women. In her opinion, she read an excerpt from the opinion that she had written. She announces that the Constitution of the United States, particularly its Equal Protection Clause, demanded that the Virginia Military Institute admit women. Ruth Bader Ginsburg got to deliver the opinion of the court that morning and to write it and make the law of sex discrimination, because the justice who writes the opinion gets to shape the wording as long as they can hold on to their majority. She got to do that because her sister-in-law, Sandra Day O'Connor, said she should. The Chief Justice of the United States or the senior justice in the majority gets to assign the opinion. They often assign these very visible, very important cases to themselves. In this case, he assigned it to Sandra Day O'Connor, the first woman on the Supreme Court. But she would not take it. She knew who had labored from 1970 until 1980 to make the Constitution apply to women. This should be Ruth's, she said. And so it came that Ruth Bader Ginsburg got to write and deliver, this is considered the opinion of her career so far, the opinion in United States versus Virginia. I think that that encapsulates, in a sense, what the book is about. It's about their relationship. It's about the way that they were better for being together than either one of them would have been separately. They were a synergy. They were greater than the sum of their parts. And when Ginsburg got to the Supreme Court, O'Connor mattered more to her than any other justice because she knew she was a pioneer. And she wanted to be sure that O'Connor's experience when Ginsburg came would be changed in a good way. So they had what I call an affectionate alliance. They were not BFFs. And I think it's really useful for women to grasp the concept of an affectionate alliance, or even a neutral alliance. They each O'Connor gave Ginsburg the oral tradition of getting along at the Supreme Court. So she was helpful. She wanted Ginsburg to succeed. She said when she was appointed, it's okay to be the first, but I do not want to be the last. She wanted Ginsburg to succeed. So she helped her in that way. But they did not get together. They did not consciously vote together. They did not consult with one another on the gender cases. I know this because I really talked to every clerk that with a pulse who would talk to me. And they tell a consistent story.
All Supreme Court justices, including the two of the subject of the book, share some things in common. They're all very smart, at least based on my knowledge of them from many years ago when I was a law clerk. And they, you know, they're just normally incredible people in a variety of ways. What do you see as similarities, and what do you see that's different about them and more striking?
I think the similarities are more interesting than the differences, because the differences are obvious, right? One from Southeast Arizona, one from Brooklyn, one Republican, one Democrat, one anti-Joe McCarthy liberal, one Goldwater girl. That's obvious, it seems to me. What's interesting to me is how they're similar. And that I learned this right as I was doing the book. They're similar in character. They're so similar in character. They are so disciplined. They are both so stunningly disciplined. People think about Sandra Day O'Connor, who got a hole in one and was a great fly fisher person. And they don't know that Ruth Bader Ginsburg also rides horses and is very competitive athletically. They are very disciplined. They have a magical thing that they share. They never believed that they were inferior. They believed that they were entitled to rule. You get it from the letters perfectly. And here they are from such different backgrounds, and they both, and they're women, and it's hard for women to not internalize their second-class status. They did not do it. Disciplined, thought they were entitled to rule, took offense when they were told they couldn't rule, waited to take their revenge cold if they couldn't get it right away. And if they could not get revenge, then they took the advice that Martin Ginsburg's mother gave to her would-be daughter-in-law on the wedding day. Mrs. Ginsburg, Marty's mother, gave Ruth a pair of earplugs as a wedding gift and said, sometimes it pays to be a little deaf. These are incredibly functional characteristics if you're going to make a revolution, because they offered a narrow target for opposition, and they never picked unnecessary or premature battles, but when the time came, they were soldiers. So they're very similar. Isn't that weird?
Well, you know, it's interesting, because my impression of Justice O'Connor, and I think I said this to you a little bit earlier, is that I could see her not being a lawyer. I could have seen her staying in the Arizona legislature. I could have seen her being governor. But she could do many, many things, and she sort of went with the flow. She clearly had great confidence. Justice Ginsburg, by contrast, she seemed to me to fall into exactly what she should have been, which she is, and what she was all about. And when you talk about being strategic, I think she devoted her whole life to the basic axis of the book, which is achieving equality for women through the law, as it were, from the time when she was at the ACLU and so on. And that contrast sort of stuck in my mind. I thought Justice O'Connor came to her decisions in that area because she thought they were the right decisions. But she could have done so many different things.
Absolutely.
In a different way. And I didn't quite see that for Justice Ginsburg.
No.
You may be right, because I didn't realize she rode too.
Yeah, right. There you go, you see. But no, I mean, there was talk about running O'Connor for president. And one of her law clerks and I have had a dialogue in the course of my book tour, and O'Connor's law clerk said you couldn't walk down the block in under 15 minutes with her because she was stopping and greeting everybody and kissing babies. This is her last year on the Supreme Court of the United States. She was doing this. She was incredibly charismatic, and she was a very good politician. And she could definitely have gone in different directions. She was happy sitting on the Arizona appellate court hearing workman's comp cases. I mean, she was a social being. She was a social animal, and she could absolutely have had a different life. She was a successful law student. She was second or third in her class at Stanford. But Ruth Bader Ginsburg was a natural at the game that goes from law school to clerkship to federal court judge. That trajectory, she was a natural on. And she, I was talking at Harvard yesterday with one of their very famous constitutional law professors, Martha Field, and I was talking about how Ruth Bader Ginsburg could see the future in the development of legal doctrine. So she would sometimes like lay a sentence down in an opinion, and 7 years later, right, she would harvest it. So one of the sub-themes of the book, which I think is really important, is does it make a difference to have women in the room when decisions are being discussed and made? And Sandra Day O'Connor always said, a wise woman, she knew she had enormous value as an icon and a symbol, right? She wanted to show the world that women could do the job as well as men could if they would just be let in. It's the very basic form of equality. But she did not think she would do it differently than a man. She just wanted to get in and be allowed to govern. Mm-hmm. Ruth Bader Ginsburg said that she was agnostic as to whether a woman's voice, a wise woman judge, would make a different decision than a wise man judge, right? It was being heavily discussed at the time, so they opined on it. So Ginsburg says she was agnostic. But when Sonia Sotomayor was being nominated for the Supreme Court, she said it outright. She admitted that a wise Latina woman with the richness of her experience would perhaps reach a different outcome than a male judge who had not had those experiences. They made her eat those words in her confirmation hearings. Ruth Bader Ginsburg sprang to her defense. She said, I think she's right, actually. And so having life tenure means never having to say you're sorry. So as soon as she was confirmed, Sonia Sotomayor went right back to articulating the experiences of a wise Latina woman. So if you look, you'll see now that when there are cases about criminal law that come up, Sotomayor says, you know, I had a cousin who got into that kind of trouble. She's actually saying it, and it's meaningful. People write a lot about how Thurgood Marshall's stories changed their point of view. And I think having people with a rich experience to tell their stories makes a huge difference.
If you have people who actually have different experiences, they bring to bear different things. You may reach the same conclusion, but you may reach a different conclusion.
Right.
Who knows?
But the conversation will be different, and that's something Supreme Court justices do. They write dissents. They engage in oral argument. In our business, we pay attention to those arguments, and now there's a Supreme Court press, so they get heavily reported.
Right. Well, thank you.
Thank you.